fair lady.
Your chariot awaits.
Quentin Tarantino's Death Proof.
Do I frighten you? Is it my scar?
In a 2012 roundtable with The Hollywood Reporter, Quentin Tarantino stated that the worst film he ever made was 2007's Death Proof.
This car is 100% death proof. Only to get the benefit of it, honey, you really need to be sitting in my seat.
But since this isn't his channel, I feel like playing some Death of the Author and declaring that my least favorite in his collection is actually...
A lot of lies set around this dinner table here tonight, but that you can't believe.
I always love the reaction I get when I say that. His best film is probably Inglourious Basterds, but guess what my favorite is?
Only at the Grindhouse.
Grindhouse was an ambitious 2007 project by director friends Robert Rodriguez and Quentin Tarantino, who wanted to recreate the idea of a double feature.
Two no-holds-barred feature-length motion pictures.
A grindhouse was historically the film version of a burlesque theatre, showing low-budget exploitation films with poor production values and in subpar condition. The experience was added to when other directors filmed fake trailers for more grindhouse-style films. I still wish some of these had actually gotten made.
Don't look anywhere.
There was a lot of hype surrounding Grindhouse that sadly amounted to very little, what with very few of the movie-going public knowing what they were actually going for. But we're here to talk about Death Proof.
Wow, that's fucking scary.
Yeah, well, I wanted it to be impressive. Scary tends to impress.
Death Proof could best be described as Halloween meets Vanishing Point. It's a car chase movie, also following the structure of the slasher genre.
That cowboy wisdom.
I'm not a cowboy, Pam. I'm a stuntman.
Our serial killer is a former stuntman with a car designed to be crashed on film and protect the driver, and his choice of murder is a carefully engineered car crash.
Now you actually think that he premeditatively murdered them gals?
He stalks two separate sets of girls. The first die, and the second... well. It's often considered something of a letdown among Tarantino buffs for a lengthy first half and perceived padding, which I honestly thought was a bigger problem in Django, but to each their own. Some feminists also aren't too happy for obvious reasons, but we'll get to that.
Why don't you go get ready for your lap dance?
Overall, a lot of the stylistic choices seem to work against it. The difference in two halves was inspired by the idea that some productions would run out of money and not get finished, so the result is as if two different films were edited together.
We're gonna do some stupid shit!
So already, the biggest strike against Death Proof was the fact that all its protagonists die at the 45-minute mark, and we then have to introduce a second set and establish them before the action happens.
You wanna hang with the cool kids? You got to be cool.
There are films that do this well, particularly Psycho, but a lot of viewers got turned off.
Yes, men are dogs. Oh, it's so funny. Oh, it's so funny.
There's also the fact that this is Tarantino's most female-focused film, where the main cast is 8 women to 1 man in a surprising reversal of the Smurfette principle.
Okay, Mean Girl in a high school movie, you through having a tantrum?
I'm not having a tantrum.
There's no singular strong female lead in a sea of testosterone, and the grounded tone makes it less palatable than Kill Bill, since rather than a cool, ultra-manly revenge quest, it's several minutes of women talking about their personal lives.
What's his profession?
And he likes to watch me pee.
But I'm supposed to be talking about what I take from the whole show, so...
Excuse me, most girls? What the fuck are you two?
As I said, this is Tarantino's most female-driven story, and while it would be all too easy to dismiss this as an excuse to have maximum TNA, Tarantino is nothing if not a craftsman at making engaging characters.
Black men and a whole lot of motherfucking white men have had plenty fun adoring my ass.
Even look at the cast that makes up both halves. Three of the leads are women of color.
Kim would be the girl of color.
And some of the white cast members are not the conventional leading ladies. I don't mean this as a knock on them. Zoe Bell and Vanessa Ferlito are very beautiful women, but they don't have the features of a typical Hollywood leading lady.
Nothing to write home about.
Hell, the most conventional casting choice is Mary Elizabeth Winstead, who in-universe is an actress and model, and she disappears in the last act. So there is definitely something to several unconventional casting choices in what looks like an attempt to portray a diverse set of women from different walks of life.
That if I go down to the laundry room in my building at midnight enough times, I might get my ass raped.
Don't do your laundry at midnight.
Fuck that, I wanna do my laundry whenever the fuck I wanna do my laundry.
Laura Bogart writes, Death Proof features a plethora of babes with shapely feet, but it also shows a surprising insight about certain terrors of being a woman. Stuntman Mike is every nice guy who expects to be invited home from the bar because he bought you a drink. Kim, the badass stunt driver, admits to carrying a gun because she fears being raped if she goes into the laundry room at midnight. And Abernathy worries that as a single mother, she'll be seen as unhip and left behind by her friends.
So, what is it you two daredevils are doing that I'm just so uncool I couldn't possibly understand?
Outside of that, we also have Jungle Julia, the self-made woman who...
What I do is work my ass off to get my own record label off the ground.
...and still has her success attributed to sleeping around just because of her past behavior.
You don't even want to know what she did for that billboard. Enjoy it, cocksucker. You earned it.
And there's an implication of her dealing with the prejudice that women of color can't be successful on their own merits.
But if you want to get with Jungle Julia, there's a real easy way to do that.
For contrast, Django's Brumhilda could be replaced with a lamp and the story would still make sense for all the characterization she's given. The women of Death Proof are unconventional, fully formed, and actually unidealized.
Oh, billboard!
The male gazey framing is a deal breaker for a lot of viewers, but since we're here to open a discussion, here's a little pipe bomb about gaze theory.
Male gaze theory is over 40 years old. It came into fashion when many people still thought homosexuality was a mental illness. It's been rendered essentially obsolete by intersectionality theory, which teaches us that you can't treat individual men as though all men are the same.
The biggest flaw in gaze theory is that it assumes there is only one look that every male prefers. And while there is certainly a Hollywood beauty standard that's favored, that's not the case in Death Proof. Notably, Kim and Jungle Julia wear their hair curly.
Look at that hair.
Lots of leave-in conditioner.
And the flaws in objectification theory come from a very sex-negative place. So we should instead turn to Martha Nussbaum's 7 parameters for treating a person like an object. I'll skip ahead to the end and say that within these parameters, the women of Death Proof do not apply.
Now look, I ain't stalking y'all, but I didn't say I wasn't a wolf.
So if we acknowledge that the frame invites us to stare in a story about voyeurism, we also have to acknowledge that the script invites us to view the women as people rather than objects of visual pleasure.
Because when I'm staying at the lake house with my girlfriends in our bikinis, Danny just has a tendency to pump up and make sure we don't need anything.
And the context of when Death Proof was made is very important when taking into account the first half, which is all building up to Arlene giving a lap dance to a complete stranger. All of a sudden in walks a chick in Mexico. While the film is dripping in nostalgia for the 70s, it reflects the 2000s in a way that maybe wasn't intended.
Y'all grew up watching that Pretty in Pink shit.
Oh, I like Pretty in Pink.
We can assume Jungle Julia, Shanna, and Arlene are late 20s or early 30s, meaning they were children in the 70s and 80s, and teenagers in the 80s and 90s, meaning they were the generation of women who, thanks to the impact of the AIDS epidemic, had to become more assertive and outspoken about their sexuality.
The messaging at then was, no, girl, talk about sex, because if you were just complacent, then he might not wear a condom and you could get AIDS.
This is reflected in the fashion and music of the 90s, which became far more sexually aggressive on the female end. And the core of it was all about asserting control over your own body and what you do with it. So Arlene begins the film not really as a prude, but someone conflicted between wanting to enjoy herself and still be respected as a person.
We just fucking met each other. I mean, if you don't bust their balls a little bit, they're never gonna respect you.
You see Abernathy dealing with this as well.
If I fucked him, I wouldn't be his girlfriend. I'd be one of his regulars.
This sets them apart from their more sexually liberated friends.
I don't wear their teeth marks on my butt for nothing.
And you see Arlene learning to explore her sexuality while also setting boundaries.
When you say done, it's done.
I'm gonna remember you said that.
So when she gives Stuntman Mike the dance, it's a mark of her taking control of her sexuality and having fun, knowing she can maintain her boundaries. In Mexico, she threw her arms around my neck. In Mexico. In a sense, she doesn't care as much about strangers respecting her, because she finally respects herself. And going back to Death Proof's 70s influence, the first half focusing on sexual politics and the second half on female empowerment ties into the Grindhouse homage in more ways than one.
One shot is what it's all about. Deer has to be taken with one shot.
It's often agreed that the cynical new Hollywood era of the late 60s and early 70s resulted in a new type of storytelling. A new type of freedom in the types of stories that could be told thanks to the collapse of the Hays Code. But it was this era that also led to the now all too familiar male-driven narrative as the default. The Golden Age, by contrast, recognized women as consumers too, and released big-budget films aimed at them, but New Hollywood saw mostly male-centered stories, with women in supporting roles, and less of them compared to the men. With more freedom about on-screen nudity, sexualization of women increased to an absurd degree, and that's what led to the essay that coined the male gaze in the first place. But this also went the other way, as it was the 70s that saw cinema's first action heroines emerge, notably Coffey and Foxy Brown also letting a woman of color save the day.
Let me see you crawl over here, you black trash.
You want me to crawl?
It was these B-movies, also including Black Christmas and Halloween, that had women saving themselves or at least fighting back, before mainstream Hollywood started doing it too. So you could argue that Death Proof reflects this transition. The first half are sexualized and then killed off, while the second are sexually liberated and save the day. But I'm supposed to be just gushing about why I love this film.
Yes!
Well, we can begin with the characters.
I am not gonna fuck him.
I can hear you.
I first tuned in for Rose McGowan, so of course Pam is one of the favorites.
Might have kicked my ass a couple of times. Sorry, I'm built like a girl, not a black man.
I love the banter between Arlene, Jungle Julia, and Shanna.
Excuse me for living, but what is the thing?
You know, it's everything but.
They call it the thing?
I call it the thing.
Do you guys like the thing?
Shanna especially is a delight.
Look, he's totally harmless and cute as a fox ear.
I used to find Abernathy a bit of a wet blanket, but I've warmed to her.
It's nice to be nice, Kim.
Whatever.
Kim also deserves way more love.
I'll crack your back.
You'll crack it anyway.
I want to see her get her own movie.
However, whatever with your however.
And I'll always love Zoe Bell.
Where's the maniac?
Shot him and his punk ass sped off.
You want to go get him?
I think this may have been my first Kurt Russell experience too.
He's old enough to be my
dad. I can still hear you.
And the two car chases the second half is building towards more than deliver. Done with practical effects and allowing Zoe Bell to perform all the stunts herself without swapping out a double just adds to the experience.
I'm okay.
Outside of these scenes, there are so many others carefully crafted and shot in such a way that's just so engaging for me to watch. I basically geek out at this film the way film students normally do for Django.
Did you hear me, butterfly? Miles to go before you sleep.
I can acknowledge that Death Proof may be a flawed film, but most works of art are, if you think about it.
All the classics.
Old Quentin may call this his worst film, but it was still at least one person's gateway to his work, and that's worth celebrating. Touch,